Good morning. Thank you, Barb, so much. So, steadfastly facing the one, I know there is no loss, no lack, no absence of anything. There is only the perfection of life unfolding in its infinite goodness and joy. Can you imagine me standing doing my spiritual practices at my dining room table every single morning doing that with such verve and vigor? It's not a pretty sight, but I'm by myself, so it's okay. So anyone recognize where that is from? If you do, I invite you to put it into the chat. Got to do it quick, though, because I'm going to tell you. That affirmation, that piece is from Emma Curtis Hopkins. So I have been taking a course on Emma from one of my former students, Reverend Jill Brocklehurst. I know I have mentioned it here before, but there is something for me so magical about seeing the flows of time where the student has become the teacher. And it's just touches my heart in a way I probably can't even fully express with words. And my teacher, Dr. Tom Costa, used to say, "You'll know that you have done a good job in ministry when your students surpass you." And I feel that's the truth. I have Reverend Jill, I've got Barb and Gwen doing great work in Kenya. It warms the cockles of my heart for sure. So it's already March the 7th. However, it is still a new month, which means a new Center for Spiritual Living theme. And this month is open to possibilities. So, as Barb kind of alluded to, here we are 1 year into the pandemic. And our rather upheaved lives, which are quite different than they were pre-COVID. So next Sunday will be a full year since we were together physically as a spiritual community. And when I look back then, I wonder, could I have imagined for a moment what would have been before us? And honestly, the answer is no. Then I also started to wonder, though, if I could never have imagined the whole planet pretty much shutting down, what might be possible going forward that I cannot imagine as I stand here today? So, could we imagine in the next year true peace, food equity, education for all, equality of all types? And just a little shout out for a Women's History Month in the U.S. Do you know, though, it's October here in Canada. So there you go. So just think of those possibilities, though. And we know now just how much the world can really shift in a relatively short period of time. And so I want to know that we could be moving into something amazing in the future. So for sure, this last year has revealed many things and has given me, for sure, I hope us, cause to look at our lives, our habits, and probably what we've taken for granted. Additionally, I think we've been given the opportunity to clarify our values and to truly learn what is important for us. And whether we've liked it or not, there has been the growth of our awareness. And, you know, where we go next, I think, for me, is much more wide open than I might have perceived it to be, especially compared to a year ago, when I know for myself, I was kind of in living more out of a sense of habit than I think what might have been good for me. Mm-hmm. So my title today is Living in the Question. And I actually think I should have called it Living in the Mystery, but it's okay. And so I have a quote from Brother Wayne Teasdale. He is a monk, put it that way. And this is from his book called The Mystic Heart, where he said, "Spirituality serves as our greatest single resource for changing our centuries-old trajectory of violence and division. Spirituality is profoundly transformative when it inspires in us the attitude of surrender to the mystery." I also have a quote from a more modern mystic, Tama Keeves, and she says, "You may find yourself in transition. You feel as though you are floundering or paralyzed because you can't see what moves to make. Relax. Take a deep breath because you're not in the middle of disarray, but in the middle of perfection. And just because your precious mind doesn't see a plan doesn't mean there is not a plan that will blow your mind." And she says, "Oh, believe me, there is." And without a doubt, much of the world before us looks like the unknown, whether that's being in the question or in the mystery. And right now, I am seeing and hearing more and more about some of the distressing mental and emotional effects of living in such uncertain times. And I know for myself, honestly, I'm feeling it. And you know, I actually am one of those people who can endure a lot. I have a very, very, and I think probably sometimes too, wide bandwidth. I have a lot of patience, I have a lot of endurance, and I have a lot of ability to just keep on keeping on. And I noticed for myself, even with those pretty strong capabilities, I was starting to feel the strain. And I am not going to lie, I still feel it. But I have come across a few practices, a few go-tos that are really helping me through. And so I wanted to share them with you this morning. And one was the Emma affirmation that I started with, that steadfastly facing the one. And I'll get more to that in a bit. And today, what I really want us to think about is living in and from that question of what could be possible as we open up to sort of that impress of a higher ideal and tap into the realm of possibilities much greater than we might be able to imagine in ourselves from our own human thinking. And, you know, this teaching is very, very clear on our personal ability to conceive new mental ideas and create experiences through our thinking. And lately, I felt the need, and you know, when I was kind of considering all of this, it really was more of a yearning to go beyond what I myself could think of and hold in place with my personal willpower. And so along came Emma, which was just what I needed. And I really, really hope that you are finding that sometimes things just sort of come along that are exactly what you need. And I hope, too, that you are saying yes to them. Anyway, I am very aware that some of you are total Emma fans and very, very experienced in the Emma ideas and practices. But honestly, I had a heck of a time wrapping my head around her writing and really understanding her. Through the years, I'd read high mysticism, I'd read scientific Christian mental practice, and I tried and I tried, you know, I'd get a little gem once in a while, but for the most part. So then I figured that I needed an interpreter. And so along comes a Center for Spiritual Living course based on a book called Unveiling Your Hidden Power, Metaphysics for the 21st Century by Ruth Miller, which was a modern language version of Emma. But I ended up still needing a teacher, and so yay, Reverend Jill. So I wanted to share a couple of Emma's lessons today, and I think they are so powerful because what I experienced is that they take me out of the realm of appearances and the material aspects of my humanity, and they move me into the mystery, into the something greater, a world that is beyond our earthly affairs. And the first practice is easy. And many of you might have heard this one before, but it's profound, and I hope you find this to be the case. And it is simply, we have a visual. Look up. Just look up. That's all you have to do is look up. But here's how it goes. We're going to actually practice this. So I want you all to think of a problem that you are having and really think about the story of it. Think of something sort of heavy and burdensome that you can't think your way out of right now. And just for a moment, I promise I will not leave you here. As you think of that issue, I want you to cast your gaze downward. Look down at the floor. And just think of that thing and feel it and mull it and see how it feels like in your body and your mind. Does it feel like it'll be there forever and there's no solution? It's just horrible, it's terrible, and there's no hope. Feel that. Now, I want you to think of that same problem. And this time, though, keep your gaze at eye level. Think of that thing, look straight out. Now check in and see how that feels in your body and your thoughts. And just maybe, does it just feel a little bit less dark, a little less foreboding? But I'm thinking it's likely you can still feel it, and it's still an issue. Now, with that same situation in your mind, still mulling over that issue, cast your gaze upward. Look up to about a 45-degree angle. And now, check into your body and check into your mind. And how does it feel? Is there just a little more sense of openness, of possibility, maybe even the brightness of a little bit of hope? So I trust that you can feel that shift, that difference in energy from looking down where it all feels so dark and heavy, and looking up, which feels open and free. Emma called this right view, or gazing toward the heights. And I love that I can directly and physically feel and experience that energetic shift when I do this. And it really helps me get out of my human head that thinks that she has got to come up with all the answers and the solutions. It lifts me to an inner place beyond appearances, where in truth, capital T truth, all is well. So the next time you are in a pickle, a difficulty, or a challenge, remember to just look up. There is something about that gaze up that truly shifts our relationship to what's going on down here in the world of form. For me, it just feels like it opens a portal to a higher place. And this is the transformative power of spirituality that Brother Teasdale referred to in his quote. This is about going direct to the inner knower that knows. And we might not get the mental or the material answer right away. Or we might. You know, I would never want to limit it. But in my experience, every time I look up, I get that feeling tone of good, which I know must then eventually outpicture into my world of experience. And for me, you know, there's also something about surrender in all of this. So, who, maybe, of any of you out there, might have a tendency to sometimes feel like you're just doing it all alone? That whatever is going on, you're the one who has to figure it out. And I know that sometimes that can be a very lonely and separate place. I know I have been there of late. But when I look up, I do that simple thing and I lean into the infinite, I feel the something more kind of swoop me up, and I have a renewed faith that things will work out if I will let, allow, and surrender to them. So back to our world right now. in this moment of time, we really don't know how things are going to turn out. And since we can't truly know the ending, for myself, I decided what I can do, what I can know, and what I can keep is my faith. As Ernest Holmes said, we don't know, maybe we don't know, but there is something that knows. And I dare say it's time for me for sure to lean into that. Holmes also said, there is a power for good in the universe, and we can use it. And this power is working on our behalf. And I need to clear myself so that it can work through me. And like this. So this takes me to the next practice, which is the one that I opened with. Now, this one is a little bit bolder, is the only word that comes to me, than look up. You know, just saying, you can do look up anytime, anywhere, and not look too weird. But this one, steadfastly facing the one, there is no loss, lack, or absence. There is only perfection. Well, you kind of got to pick your places where you're going to do that. So there's a little bit more behind this one, and I'm going to save most of that for some kind of future Emma class. But it is based on what she calls negations, which are beliefs or stories we have about what life is or isn't that aren't true in the realm of spirit. For example, in the world of spirit, there is, we know, only light, love, life, peace, power, beauty, joy, and supply. Therefore, Emma says, anything that is not those things isn't real. They are not the capital SR. They are not the spiritual reality. So things like loss, lack, or absence are not the spiritual truth. So we remind ourselves of this because we are spiritual beings by saying, steadfastly facing the one, there is no loss, lack, or deprivation. And of course, those are just my personal negations, and you'll have your own. And then we add the affirmation at the end that spirit is infinite beauty, joy, peace, and good. Emma also reminds us that in spirit, there is nothing hurtful. There is no sickness and even no death. In fact, she says over and over again, there is only life eternal. But by negating those falsehoods, we turn ourselves back to what spirit is, the perfection of life unfolding. So, just a little sidebar, because, you know, all of that might sound very unreal and hard to grasp for us here on Earth. When we can look around to our material world and we can say, well, there's poverty, there's sickness, there's lack. But because this is about the life of spirit, again, it is about a different realm, one where the rules of the physical are transcended, not by magic, but by our belief and by our faith. There is an infinite life supporting us. Emma calls it the world of good. And it's our faith that allows us to see it and live in it. And so again, you know, nobody can tell us where our planet is going. You know, prior to March 2020, I thought, we had a stable, predictable world that we could count on. We didn't realize that that was part of the illusion. However, what we do know is that there is only one thing happening, and we can turn to and rely on that regardless of what is going on out there. And our opportunity is to build our faith in that thing itself. We have dominion over our minds, our thoughts, and how we practice the greater life that is implanted within each of us. And to bring this forward, we must do what it takes within us to reveal our awareness of this spiritual world. This is the consciousness that will carry us forward, revealing that power and presence of good. And as we do this, that world of spirit will be reflected back to us into our world of experience as well. So our task is to transform our perspective, to look up and to steadfastly face the one and to live from the mystery of the perfection of that goodness. Thank you for joining us this morning. I'm delighted you are here. Peace and blessings to all.